it was just a really good trip. And I'm not going to say too much about it. I don't think I'd get through it right now. Maybe in a month or so I'll talk about it a little bit. But 1 Samuel chapter 23. I was impressed at Matt's skill at climbing coconut trees. I don't think I'd ever seen that before in my life. That was very impressive, brother, wherever you're at. And the one shot was misleading with him carrying bananas on his head. He was standing there without his head. He wasn't carrying them anywhere. Would not stay up there at all. But he did a really good job. I appreciate all those who went. Was a good trip. 1 Samuel chapter 23, let me start there in verse, if you remember when we left off here a couple weeks ago here in 1 Samuel 23, David has gotten himself right with God again. He's encouraged himself in the Lord, and he's starting to act like a king, even though he's not king yet, when we get into chapter 23. And he had delivered this city that was a border town with the Philistines. It was, of course, in Judah, in Israel. And he delivered them. But he knew he had to go back into hiding because Saul was coming after him with the army. So he escapes. And the last verse we read, he's basically hiding out whithersoever they could go. That's in verse 13. So no set dwelling place here. They're literally traveling from place to place right now with these, you know, these band of the outcast, if you will, from a few messages prior to that the Lord has assembled around David. And David's turning them to an army. He's becoming a leader of men again. But anyhow, let's pick it up in verse 14. And David abode in the wilderness in the strongholds and remained in a mountain in the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul sought him every day. But God delivered him not into his hand. And David saw that Saul was come out to seek his life, and David was in the wilderness of Ziph in a wood. And Jonathan, Saul's son, arose and went to David into the wood and strengthened his hand in God. And he said unto him, Fear not, for the hand of Saul my father shall not find thee, and thou shalt be keen over Israel, and I shall be next unto thee. And that also Saul my father knoweth. And the two made a covenant before the Lord, and David abode in the wood, and Jonathan went to his house. Let's go ahead and pray. Father in heaven, Lord, I love you. Lord, I thank you for your word. I ask your blessing now upon this time. Lord, I pray that you work in hearts. Please, Lord, I pray this would challenge us. I pray that this would help us with our walk with you and encourage us. Lord, please bless and control this, Lord. Fill me with your spirit. I love you, and I pray and ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. All right, now I mentioned we're going to have a quiz here, so if you have a piece of paper and a pen and you want to try and write some of these things down, you can. I'm going to get some questions out here that I want to ask you. And you might not have to write down much for the first set of questions. We'll just see if you know the answer to any of these. Number one, name the five wealthiest people in the world. Who are the five wealthiest people in the world? I actually do have did look it up. I do have the answers right. Who are the five wealthiest people in the world? Number two, name the top five news stories 5 years ago, 2012. Name the top five news stories of 2012. I didn't remember one. I had to look them up. Number three, name the five leaders from the biggest countries in the world. Name five leaders from the biggest countries in the world. Sure. Next question. Name five people who have won a Pulitzer Prize. You got that, Paul? Excluding this past fall, Brother Connolly, Name the last five World Series winners. The Cubs do not count because they beat the Indians. Of course, it's kind of easy. It was usually either Boston or New York. Boston and New York. That's a little bit of an easy one there. Bound to get. All right, so if you go over those, did anybody get five of the wealthiest people in the world? I do have them here if you want to check your answers. Who's the two? Yep, Gates is number one, and Buffett is number three on that list. No, he's not close. He's not, who? No. No, the other guys I've never heard of, number two is a guy named Ortega. Number three is a guy named Helu. And number four is a guy named Bezos. Oh, was that Amazon, Jeff? Yeah. Top five news stories. Anybody get any from 2012? I had to look these up. What's that? Benghazi was one in 2012. Very good. You got four more? Barack Obama was elected. That's a major news story. I don't know if it's top five, but that certainly would have been up there. What's that? Yeah, I don't think he'd make top five, brother. Yeah, but he would have been a news story, I'm sure, that time. What else have we had? Benghazi going on then. I looked up 10, and now I can't remember any. Yeah, but that's just it. I looked it up like 30 minutes ago, and I still can't remember it. Anybody got five people who have won a Pulitzer Prize? What's that? You got four more? Anybody? No. The questions I'm giving, of course, including the World Series, those are people who achieved the highest mark, the biggest accolades for their, you know, everything that was going on, whatever the case might have been. And for the most part, we can name one or two of each. And it's just because we happen to hear their names probably every day, and that's it. The reality is, those headlines of yesterday you forget, even though these were the best in their fields, the applause dies. The applause dies. Time moves on, and we do not remember things like that. We don't remember things like that. Now, I'm going to give you another set of questions, okay? Name three people who have helped you through a difficult time. Name three people who have helped you through a difficult time. Number two, name three people who have taught you something worthwhile. Name three people who have taught you something worthwhile. Number three, name three people who have made you feel appreciated and special. Number four, think of three people or name three people you enjoy spending time with. Lastly here, name three people who have helped you with your walk with the Lord. My guess is those were pretty easy to come by. Because what we remember deals with our relationships, what actually affects us in everyday life. And yet, too often, we concentrate our time on those other things up there. Jonathan wasn't that way. Jonathan, and one of my purposes of this message is just to, you know, we all need like a Jonathan in our life, but that's not the direction I want to go with this. You know, I think that we need to be a Jonathan. We need to be one that's the encourager. We need to be the one that is there for somebody that's in a difficult time. We need to be the one that teaches somebody something that's going to help them in their life. Yet we spend our time striving to be the wealthiest. The fact is, nobody will remember your name. Do you understand that? Nobody. I don't care if you hit the pinnacle of your career. When you're dead, you'll be forgotten. Do you understand that? You'll be forgotten. But yet, when you're there for somebody, you'll be remembered. Because it actually makes a difference. It actually makes a difference. The people you remember are those who made a difference in your life. Those who change you, who strengthen you, and help you. It is not the ones with power, money, or status. All of that is vanity. And most of the time, that is people just filled with themselves and filled with pride. Instead of seeing how wretched they really are. Anyhow, Jonathan was someone who made a difference in David's life. He was always there for him. when he needed him. Right now, David, although he's certainly not backsliding like he was before, and we do see Jonathan, as we went through this, at times when David was in a backslidden condition, when Jonathan was there for him and trying to get a hold of this guy to get his head on straight, and now he's here. He just knows, he knows that David is certainly going through a difficult time. I mean, Saul is now after him every single day, every day. And they're moving from place to place to place to place. And, of course, the Lord allows Jonathan, of course, to find him. And Jonathan is there for him once again. Again, not only do we all need a Jonathan in our life, but we need to be a Jonathan to someone else. I assure you, there's people right here in this room that you have no idea that could certainly use your encouragement. But too often what begins to take place in our life, we're not looking for that. And I assure you, if you're looking to be the encourager, you're going to get encouraged yourself. You know, and instead of when it comes to January and February in Alaska, instead of talking how miserable it is, let's talk about how great it is. Let's try and be an encouragement and go the other way with this direction. But let's look at some things here with Jonathan that I notice in our text. One thing we see is within Jonathan's relationship with David, Jonathan had a very unselfish relationship with David. As we're reading through this again, he hits David. Well, once again, he lets him know, David, you are going to be king. Look back there at verse, 17, I believe it is. Yeah, verse 17. And he said unto him, fear not, for the hand of Saul my father shall not find thee, and thou shalt be king over Israel. He's incredibly unselfish. He knows David, he is putting David before himself, and the guy is just... he's one of my favorite people in the Bible for how he is with his unselfishness. Again, you would think, too, that he would want him to be dead. If he was carnally minded, he would want David dead. He would be there to put a dagger in him, because if David survives, he is not king. But if he kills David, guess who's going to be the next king? It will be Jonathan. But that wasn't what he was worried about most. He wasn't the guy who was worried about the prestige and all that stuff. That wasn't Jonathan. What he was worried about was the will of God. That's what he was obsessed with, was the will of God. A true friend, as we see here in Jonathan, has your best interest in mind. He has your best interest in mind. And Jonathan, Saul's son, arose and went to David into the wood and strengthened his hand in God. He had David's interest in mind. You want to let him know, as his father's chasing him day after day after day, he's telling David, just keep on going. And again, a true friend will have your best interest in mind. And sometimes Jonathan had to be stern with David. We saw that, you know, several sermons ago in this series on the life of David, because that's what David needed to hear. There was times basically he had to kick him, he had to, you know, slap him around a little bit and say, David, come on, what are you doing? But he had his best interest at heart. We all need people to strengthen us in our walk with God. We all need those Jonathans in our life. Really, we could divide people in our life into two categories: those who draw us closer to God and those who draw us away from God. You know, and if you think about that, and if you'll be honest before the Lord, he can draw that, he can bring those names right to mind. And of course, the group you need to stay with are those that are going to strengthen your hand in God, not those that are going to pull you away, not those that want to hinder you in your work with God, regardless even of how faithful they are to church. It's those that genuinely want to see your walk strengthened with the Lord. Jonathan was like that. He wanted David to keep on going, to keep on serving God. Remember, Jonathan was a man of faith. This wasn't, I mean, he has some amazing battle victories just like David. So a true friend is somebody, one that has your best interest in mind. I think we see that in verse 16. Verse 17, a true friend sees what you are now and what you can become. He sees where you're at now, but he also sees what you can become. Verse 17, I've already read that. That's when he's telling David, listen, fear not, it's all right. You're going to be king. That's what's going to take place. Just like he always told him. You always see Jonathan reminding David of that. He's letting him know, listen, you're going to be king. This is going to take place. And again, it's when we finally get into chapter 23, when he had a previous discussion with Jonathan, you know, sometime prior to that, that he finally starts to act like a king. And Jonathan again, a true friend sees what you are now and what you can become. Jonathan knew David would be king. He encouraged him in that direction. He was encouraging him in the will of God. I was thankful for my pastor when I was a teenager, a man named Bill Shomo, and that the interest that he had took in me, he was sort of, I've had several different Jonathans in my life, but still what he saw, especially that first day that I actually had my own conversation with him, what he saw in me, I have no idea. I'm standing in my driveway, I have the rock music blasting, I'm just in my shorts and hacky sack. That's what I'm doing, a hacky sack ball in a driveway. And he walks up and I let him know my mom's inside, you can go inside. He said, I didn't come to see your mom, I came to talk with you. Man, I was glad he did. Know what he's trying to do? He was trying to strengthen my hand in God. He saw what I was right there. That was pretty obvious. But he also saw what I could become. And that was the direction he was pulling me. I was thankful that day the Lord put it on his heart on that Saturday morning to go by my house. And there's been others in my life the whole time, you know, that, and God will put those in your life. As you respond to God, he'll have the Jonathans in your life. He'll have them come around and try and push you in the direction that you're supposed to go. So a true friend, again, he sees what you are now and what you can become. Now, the key for Jonathan was this, because we all need to be Jonathan. I want you to understand, the key for Jonathan here, Jonathan had flesh just like you or I. I have no doubt that there was nights in Jonathan's mind that he dreamed of being king of Israel. He was human. He was a man. How could he not? So what was the key to his life? Well, the key was his relationship to God. I believe Jonathan's key was his relationship with God. Because Jonathan was right with God, he could have the unselfish attitude that was needed in his relationship with David. God was first in his life. The reason why he was able to put David first and encourage him the way that he did, it wasn't just simply his love and his friendship for David. It was because the man was right with God. That's what enabled him to maintain this attitude throughout. He had the right relationship to God. In order for us to have the right relationship with others, we first must have a right relationship with God. When you're having problems in your marriage, one of the very first things that I work on in marriage counseling, some people think it's a side issue, and I'm not going to a side issue at all. I'm getting to the root of the problem. And that is dealing with your relationship with God. Because if I can get you right with God, I can get you right with your spouse. The secret to Jonathan's success in his relationship with David was not his love for David. It was his love for God. It was his love for God. If you're walking with God, you're going to love those in your life as you should. All right? You're going to have a right relationship with the spouse. You're going to have the right attitude, because the right attitude is going to flow from your desire for God. We do right not just for the sake of doing good. We do right out of our desire to please God. That's what maintains your ability to do right. I mean, people have different motivations for why we do right. Christians have different motivations for why they do right. But the one that will sustain that is going to be the one who's doing right to please God. You know, when your children, begin to pull away from the Lord when they get older, when they get out of the house, and we tend to blame it on different things. Well, they saw this in church, and they saw this in church, or this took place, or this took place. No, you're missing it. I assure you, 100% of humanity has had bad experience in churches. It's filled with sinners. There's not one. You're not dealing with the heart of the issue. The relationship that the person had with God. That was the problem. It wasn't the hypocrite that they saw in church. That became the excuse to follow the flesh. Again, if we have problems with others, we need to first concentrate on our own walk with God. You know, that's where you kind of pull the beam out of your own eye so you can see the mote that's in your brother's. (Clears throat) Again, we can even make this part even more practical right here. You know, when you're struggling with a particular sin in your life, I think you need to deal with that. I'm not saying that. But the key to being successful in that struggle with a sin in your life is your relationship to God. That's the key to that. You see, if you have a problem with alcohol and it keeps on grabbing you, the only thing that you're really dealing with is the alcohol, and you're setting up the guardrails, which is good. I'm for that. Please don't misunderstand me. But if all you're doing is you're just going to set up these temporary restraints, you're going to put up these different walls in place to try and prevent you from falling into that's good. But I also believe that eventually you will fail because you're not dealing with the root of the problem. I believe that there's a whole other step that needs to come about, that we begin to do right and we begin to do good because of our relationship with God. It's at another level now at that point in time. Again, the key to breaking that is not simply working on the sin issue, but strengthening your relationship with God, who has the power to break the bondage. And parents, this is true. When you're dealing with your children and raising your kids, listen, you want them to do right because God is their God, not just because of mom and dad. You want them to do right because they choose to do right. You know, at times the Lord will give you different teachable moments, and where you let them know. I'm talking from a very young age, like when they're 3 and 4 years old. When they're 3 and 4 years old, let's say you hear a comment from them that you might think is cute, but it might have some rebellion in it. And use that as a teaching moment. Don't bend them over and start wailing on them. All right? I mean, there's a time to spank. But look for those teachable moments with the Lord. You know, all of a sudden you hear a comment or something like that, you know, the Holy Spirit maybe raises a flag. If you listen to that, like, dang, you better listen to what that just said. Use that as a teachable moment. Don't laugh about it or anything like that. Grab them and say, listen, no, what's most important is God, serving Him. And you don't want to go that route. Let Him see it. Let Him see you mean business with this. Let Him see it's more than just Sunday morning Christianity. Because the time's going to come when that young person has to make that decision, when God becomes their God. We also see Jonathan and his relationship. You know, I think that was key to all this. Secondly, we see Jonathan's resolve. What I like about this is David is on the run now day after day after day. He's on the run every day. Yet Jonathan found him. That took a little bit of determination on Jonathan's part. It took some resolve. He knew in his mind, you can see with the relationship how it's developed over the time already. And again, this is the last time we have these two together. The next time you hear David speaking of Jonathan, he's wailing his death. He's saying things like, oh, how the mighty have fallen. Because Jonathan had been killed. But David, now he's traveling in the wilderness right now, hiding out day in and day out. And Jonathan determined, listen, last time he saw David, remember, David was really discouraged. He was getting out of the will of God even. And Jonathan determines, I'm going to find him. I'm going to make sure he's on track. It has to get old right now with my dad trying to kill him day in and day out, and I'm having no set place. And so he determined to do something about it. You know, sometimes to be an encouragement, it isn't easy. Sometimes you have to go out of your way. But boy, it sure would be worth it for that person, wouldn't it? It wasn't easy for Jonathan, but he determined to be the help that David was going to need. And if we're going to be effective, if we're going to be a Jonathan to others in our life, we too need to determine to help others, to find someone, determine to encourage them in their walk with God. Again, parents, you do this with your children. Look to help others with their walk with God. But by the way, that also helps set up some accountability for your life. It does when you're doing that. And then lastly tonight, Jonathan's reward. And one, I do want to bring this. I do absolutely believe that it encouraged Jonathan as he encouraged David. Because he was right with God. This is dealing with the will of God. So I believe Jonathan drew encouragement from encouraging David. You know, and there's certain people in here that you are encouragers. And you can feed off that yourself. You know what I'm talking about. It encourages you when you see somebody who all of a sudden you're able to put a smile on their face. You walk away encouraged from that. And I think Jonathan was encouraged the times that he was there, especially from the last time they met. Now, I believe when he met David this time, I believe David was full of resolve. And Jonathan saw it. I think the Lord let Jonathan see that before he died, because the battle is getting ready to take place and Jonathan's going to be killed. And I think the Lord allowed Jonathan to see that of all the help that he'd been in his life. And now here's David, and he comes unto David. And I believe David just, he's ready to go. I mean, the guy's right with God. He's getting things right. And Jonathan got to see that. He got to see it. Again, Jonathan knew this was God's will, that David would be king. And again, he knew, like we looked at this morning, it's not him that planteth or him that watereth. It's God that gives the increase. I think Jonathan's reward was also that he knew he was being used of God. I think he knew he was being used of God. That's what he wanted. That's what he wanted, regardless of whether that was the king of Israel or never to be king. He simply wanted to be used of the Creator. Really, is there anything greater than that? To be used of the Creator? There's not a position on this earth that could possibly succeed that. Nothing could surpass that. Nothing could surpass that. I mean, because what you have here is all vanity and it's going to disappear. But when you actually surrender yourself to God and get rid of the vanities that are in this life, now what you're building is something that will last for an eternity and not be burned up when your works are nothing but ashes when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And you thought you were great stuff. And the Lord says, listen, yeah, you're saved, yet chose by fire. Come on in. There's your outhouse. Again, life is all about glorifying God and being used of Him. This is where you'll find great satisfaction, is in this. It's not in the material things. It's in this. Again, that far exceeds a large bank account. It far exceeds some top executive of a position. Would it not be great to know that the Lord has used you and helped, and you took part in keeping somebody from falling away? You took part of somebody who was getting ready to make some, just like David was, when he's getting out of the will of God, guess who was there for him? Jonathan. Hey, listen, but you're not going that direction. You're going to be king. Do you understand me? You're going to be king. Remember what God promised you. And he pulled him back. And now he's seeing him. And he knew when he left there, he knew, guy's going to be king. And he knew he had a part in that. He knew he had a part in that. Again, I would much, much, much prefer to stand before God knowing that I help people in the will of God than doing my best to pull them away from the will of God, to follow the ways of the world. And I'm finished here. In conclusion, have you ever wondered what would have happened to David if Jonathan wasn't there? What if there was no Jonathan in his life? I mean, I know God's in control, would have had somebody else, but just for the sake of the point, listen to what I'm saying, okay? I mean, the Lord chose to use Jonathan to be the encourager, to strengthen his hand in the Lord. And remember, again, from parents to your relationships, you strengthen people in the hand of God, in the will of God for their life. That's what's going to matter. You know, we talked about New Guinea, and Matt had talked about how they don't have much. But I learned something over 12 years. They have so much more than what we have. It's not the house or how much clothes you have that matter. It's the relationships. It's not what matters. It's easier for them to see the truth and recognize that because of how little they do have. My fear is when much comes available. And that steals the vision that they have now. Because it's happened to us. So have you ever wondered what would have happened to David if Jonathan was not there? And then think about this. Right now, ask yourself this. Does anybody need me to be a Jonathan right now? Who is it that needs me to be a Jonathan in their life? To be the encouragement that they need. Fact is, we're all flesh. There are times I have a note on my desk. It was about a 3 or 4 week, just tough time period here a couple months ago. And I came in one morning, had a note sitting there from a Jonathan. It's still there. It'll be there for years. You know, there's times when you need that in your life. And by the way, if you're too obsessed with the things of this world, do you actually think the Holy Spirit has a chance to prompt your heart? No, because you're too self-absolved in your own bubble. And I'm telling you, listen, Jonathan drew encouragement by helping David. Not only did he encourage David, I'm telling you, that's what encouraged him. That's what encouraged him. Again, not only do we need all, we all need Jonathans in our life, and we do. But I think more importantly, we need to be a Jonathan. You know, I wonder if all of us, and all of us are guilty, including me as the pastor, we're all flesh, but just listen, if we can get a hold of this and allow it to change us even somewhat. And let's just go back a couple years. I wonder how many more people would be sitting right now in the church. I wonder how many more people would be sitting here. Now, granted, some might have just set, you know, they had their, kind of like we went through the book of Hosea, some have their heart set like flint, and that's what they're going to do. But there's others who are like David and just simply need pulled back in the right direction. Simply need pulled back in the right direction. So the question is, are you a Jonathan? With heads bowed and eyes closed.